Good morning and welcome to the third meeting of 2024 Citizens' Participation and Public Petitions Committee. Our first agenda item is simply to agree taking later agenda items in private, particularly evidence that we're going to hear this morning. Are members content to do that?
Agreed.
We are. At the last meeting, we agreed to consider the evidence we heard on P1979, which is to establish an independent inquiry and an independent national whistleblowing officer to investigate concerns about the alleged mishandling of child safeguarding inquiries by public bodies, and again on the A9 duelling project, which we've been considering, and therefore agenda items 5 and 6 will also be taken in private. Are members content? We are. That brings us to agenda item 2, which is a consideration of continued petitions, and the first of those is petition number 1947, which is to address Scotland's culture of youth violence lodged by Alex O'Kane. And the petition calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to address the disturbing culture of youth violence in Scotland. Now, at our last consideration of this petition, we took evidence from Dr. Fern Gillan and Dr. Susan Batchelor. And the committee, though previously met with an Edinburgh-based youth movement, group GVT, just off the Grassmarket, and also visited Milton in Glasgow, where we met the petitioner. Our parliamentary colleague Bob Dorris was in attendance as well. And we met families, not necessarily from the Milton area, we had people from the Fife as well present, but who had direct experience of the issues raised in the petition. They gave their evidence anonymously. Some of it was for members of the committee present. Very, very harrowing to have to hear. But I think we were extraordinarily impressed with the courage of both the individuals and their families in the candour of the evidence that they gave us. So I'd like to thank all of those who were prepared to meet with us and do that. And therefore, delighted to welcome our witnesses to the committee this morning. And we have with us Emily Beaver. I'm just suddenly aware my note is missing. I've got it on a different page. But so we've got Emily Beaver, who is the Senior Development Officer with No Knives and Better Lives. Will Linden, Deputy Head of Unit and Head of Analysis at the Scottish Violence Reduction Unit. And delighted also to have Jonathan Waters, who's the Community Policing Inspector for Police Scotland. So welcome all, and thank you all for being present. The questions we've got probably arise out of the different sessions that we've held. You're not a conglomerate, so if you have a particular view that you'd like to express, just let me know that you would like to come in, and I'll invite you to do so. So what does available evidence tell us about the level of involvement of children and young people as perpetrators of violent behaviour? We've obviously heard examples of it. Our academics didn't really think that there was a significant issue, particularly in relation to young people. Are these teenagers? Younger than that, older than that, if they're there? And is there an easily identified universal relevant factor that you think can be pointed to as the source, or is it really much more complicated than to try and summarise it in such a simplistic way, i.e., it's deprivation, or i.e. it's family, i.e. whatever. And I'm very interested to know. So who would like to kind of kick off? Quite a general introduction. We've got a starter for three. Mr. Linden, thank you.
Thank you, convener. What we know about violence in Scotland just now in terms of the young people and young people involved in violence is, you know, and it was repeated in the last committee meeting that the most of the young people in Scotland, in fact, if not a vast majority of the young people in Scotland, are not involved in violence, they're not involved in criminality, they're an absolute credit to their country, their family and their communities. However, what we also know as well is there are groups of young people that are involved in violence, some through, you know, they're being assaulted, being victims themselves, some get involved in violence in terms of actually committing violence. The age groups tend to change in terms of what they're involved in. The older the age group, the more violent it's likely to be. The younger age groups, we've seen through things like the Bissell report, tend to be kind of low-level violence and antisocial behaviour. The numbers are not terribly high. However, each community is different. When we look at specific communities and specific areas, people's experiences of violence change. I've been involved with the Violence Reduction Unit since it started. I've been there since the days of John Carnigan and Karen McCluskey. And violence in Scotland has changed and has significantly came down. And this has been driven by young people's behaviour in the main. Young people's behaviour has changed over that period of time. Less of them were involved in carrying weapons, less of them involved in violence and gang violence. But when you look at the actual instances of violence, it's not equal. We've got some communities out there that experience violence, some families experience violence a lot more, and that goes for groups of young people as well. So when we talk about reductions in violence across a country and changes across a country, for some people, some communities and some individuals, it doesn't feel that way. It feels very different, particularly if you're the mother of someone that's been assaulted, or you've been assaulted yourself, or you've lost someone to violence. Violence is horrific. Violence tarnishes our communities and tarnishes what we look at. If I was looking at it in terms of age groups, you have to look at it in terms of the behaviours of what the age groups are doing in terms of how we tackle it. We need to think about the young people and how we prevent it. We're looking at the kind of that kind of teenage group that was mentioned in terms of some of the more serious violence. But some of the most serious violence that we see in the country is not committed by young people. It's committed by people over the age of 20. And we've seen that trajectory increase over that period of, since I've been involved in this, since 2005. It's increased year after year after year of that age group that's involved in serious violence. You cannot tackle violence just by tackling it at a youth-level culture. We must tackle violence across the country and look at it across all age groups, because if we don't, we're not setting the best example.
And just to follow up before I come to you, I think our academics suggested that the historical kind of territorial gangland violence amongst young people is less of an issue than it once was, and that the violence as such and the way that it occurs is different in its pattern.
Well, the territorial violence that we've seen, it was obviously a highly sort of promoted or, you know, reported on from, for example, Glasgow in the kind of mid-2000s. It's not disappeared, no. It's not away, but it is significantly reduced. At one point, I think we're reporting on, you know, 50, 60, 70 gangs with 600 members. We don't see those level of numbers now in terms of young people that are involved in it. We don't see the large territorial fighting on the streets that we used to see in the parks on the Friday and Saturday night. But it does still happen. But what we're also seeing as well is the influence of other factors such as social media. And we're seeing the influence of that kind of expansion of networks and how people connect together. So territorialism has changed. It's not necessarily just connected upon who your next door neighbour is. This idea of networks and social networks has broadened over that period of time. And that has affected how we respond to it too.
We want to look in some detail at the influence of social media in the last 10, 15 years. Specifically. Emily Beaver, you were going to come in.
Yes, thank you. Yeah, I think for us, would echo what Will had said, that the majority of young people aren't involved in violence, and that's really important. It's a kind of foundation of prevention, is actually having that reassurance for young people that the majority of young people aren't carrying weapons, for example, are not going to be involved in violence, because actually it's a lot of time that fear factor. If we create that social norm and we create the feeling that the violence is just around the corner, that young people will be kind of on edge. They might start taking measures like carrying weapons because they think that would keep them safe. You know, if the perception is there that there is, in fact, lots of young people who are ready to jump into violence. And we certainly want to avoid that, because that's not the case. I don't know if the committee had seen, but the last time the Scottish Government did a deep dive, certainly into weapons carrying and the profile of individuals involved in weapon carrying, both those responsible and those harmed by, it was actually those in their late 20s. 27, 29, depending on the classification of the weapons carrying. To address one of your initial questions about a universal factor, I would say, of course, it's more complex. There's not a universal factor, but there are things like poverty, like the mental health crisis, like the fracture in relationships from COVID, that means that violence is more likely, or it's kind of setting young people on a path that makes it harder to make positive decisions for themselves and their peers.
Jonathan Waters,
I would agree with both Emily and Will the vast majority of people, of young people that come into the city centre, come in to enjoy the attractions of the city centre. There's obviously quite often not a lot for them to do in their local area, and they come into the city centre and quite often don't have much money on them as well, so there is an element of hanging about. But that doesn't necessarily mean that they're doing anything wrong. It might be a perception for members of the public that they are, but more often than not, they're not doing anything wrong. In terms of what Emily was saying, there's certainly no universal factor. Sometimes things like alcohol can have a factor in the way that the children, young people present to us. I wouldn't say that's just one of many factors. From the sort of analysis and statistics that we've got, the age group is between sort of 26 and 35. You're more likely to be involved, and you're male, you're more likely to be involved in violence than a young person.
I mean, obviously, the committee's concern is particularly amongst younger people, and the victims of violence that we met were 12 or 13 years of age. One was the subject of that violence on a school bus. One was a slightly withdrawn individual who was artificially befriended and more or less invited by appointment to be assaulted. And we might have a chance to look at some of that in more detail later. But obviously what the committee therefore was hearing was, and these were girls, and they were attacked by other girls, was of really horrendously despicable acts at a relatively young age, egged on by the peer group who was in attendance. And I wanted to understand, are those two examples that I'm hearing there uniquely awful? Or in the pattern of trends, is there, however small, nonetheless, a trend at that age group of growth, however small, in youth violence?
We've just done a piece of work, actually, on violence between girls. So the specific issue, because practitioners were telling us that they felt it was becoming more frequent and perhaps more serious. The statistics don't show that because they don't record it in that way. So we went out to young people directly and spoke to them. I would say the young people that we spoke to were the majority of whom had violence really woven throughout their lives. They had both been responsible for violence, but also had been harmed through violence. And that was violence perhaps in the home, perhaps through social media, and then their kind of acts of violence where they were responsible for that harm was kind of as a result of all of those things, is what they were saying. And they were young people who were really loyal to their friends, which sometimes meant they also got involved in fights, that they said they felt that they didn't have a lot of trusting adults, for example. They said explicitly, teachers don't care until it's a crisis point, until you're in a fight. So they really felt they weren't getting support. And they were young people who were really fiercely protective of their families. Families, we found, was a real trigger point for violence. For example, if someone had said something about someone's family, but also that some families condoned violence. So I think there was a lot of pressure on these young people from all these different arenas, and that culminated in violence in some shape or form. We would say what we're really exploring now is how to support young people, girls in particular, to develop those trusting relationships with adults, that make sure they have that support in place, that they have support to navigate social media in a positive way. We put a lot of onus on young people to navigate social media. It's a really complex place that has lots of things that are acting against us, all the persuasive design and things like that are in there. But we know that young people also really lacked any kind of hope and optimism for the future. They didn't have that, and therefore they felt like that was it. This was their lot for life. It was always going to be like this. So until we have that kind of positive future for them, they felt there was nowhere else for them to go.
Yes. Mr. Waters,
I'd say, again, I agree with what Emily was saying. we don't, I'd say those two examples are uniquely awful. I would agree with that. Common assaults are quite frequent, and low-level sort of public nuisance is the top call that the police attend in Glasgow city centre that involves young people. So it is crime at a very low level that we generally deal with as opposed to these more serious matters.
Okay, we'll come back to... I mean, some colleagues attest that I represent a relatively affluent area in that I'm the MSP for the Eastwood constituency on the south side of Glasgow with some very high-income areas, but also with its own areas of less that are less fortunate. And this is another theme we might come back to, but I'm struck because I've had examples of youth violence brought to my attention too, at the lack of responsibility of parents, it seems at times, to acknowledge that their children can in any way be responsible for acts of youth violence and who therefore neither support the teachers, the school, and indeed have themselves become part of the harassing posse, if I can put it that way, of the individuals who have been the subject of the violence. And of course that's an emerging trend because teachers have been saying for a very long time to me now that particularly those who've left the profession, that if they only had to deal with the children that would be fine, but they now find having to deal with the parents almost impossible because they get very little support from them. So I say that, it's a theme I want to come back to, but I don't want to hog all the time. So David Torrens.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning to witnesses. Just to put on the record, because I know the media and everything will be watching this, experience of violence amongst children and young people, is it increasing in your opinion? Just so it's on the record.
That is a very difficult question. Is it increasing? The reporting of it isn't just now. What we're seeing it is in terms of maybe at a very low level in terms of stuff that's come through schools, etc. From a policing and recorded crime perspective, we're not really seeing that, but that's probably maybe to do with recording issues. What we're probably feeling on the ground and listening to people is there is a feeling that it's increasing. I'm just a bit concerned that that might cascade a few years down the line, maybe even 18 months' time or so, we might actually start to see an increase in recorded crime and an increase in violence. Because although we might not be seeing it just now, it does feel that way, but not at any kind of catastrophic level that is going to go out of control. I still think there's an opportunity if we intervene, we can intervene and support and help and stop this from happening, but I am concerned by that.
I wouldn't say that there's a... From looking at the data over the last 5 years, it's quite stable in terms of the number of incidents reported. There was a spike when just after COVID, which was throughout 2022. The first 11 months of that were particularly bad in terms of youth coming into the city centre just in the back of COVID and the lifting of restrictions. And that led to more reports, but since then it's kind of levelled out into the kind of, and it's, there's no real change between over the last 5 years. Might be a perception that things have got worse, but certainly from my experience and from the statistics that I've got is that there's no real change to the level.
Maybe worth saying that it's worth, if the committee hasn't seen it and looked in detail at the HBSC report, the latest version that came out last June, paints a real picture of what's going on for young people in Scotland. And it's a really bleak picture. You know, there's really not that many young people who are very happy with their lives, who are confident, there's lots of young people who feel lonely, for example. All these things that are kind of make a kind of perfect storm of situations where young people are just less able to make positive decisions. And we can really see that change since 2018. The results are really quite drastic in how those numbers have changed. So I think for sure for the committee, it's definitely worth looking at that, where there is that perspective from young people telling us how their lives really are.
Going back to violence and amongst young people, social media and your sites like Instagram and TikTok and things like that, how much has that played in an increase? Because I've seen some horrendous videos on some of your social media sites, say, them boasting about what they've done and they're quite proud about it. In fact, in 5 hours, one about a school teacher getting assaulted by a pupil went viral everywhere. So what, how's that rise in social media played a part in violence amongst young people?
To certainly young people's experience that they've told us about how they use social media. Certainly there's some enabling factors of social media. So for example, very large group chats on Snapchat was something that young people told us that are often used to coordinate fights. In fact, young people said once they were added into one of these groups that they felt like there was no way out, that they had to have a physical fight. They felt trapped, even if they didn't want to. They didn't feel there was a way out. So that was one way. And it's worth saying that as well, this is not just confined because of the networks available to young people. Some of the young people we spoke to were receiving really harrowing threats, death threats, from other young people outside of Scotland, that somehow had been, you know, added into these massive group chats or had their number somehow. So the violence that they experienced through social media as well, not just violence or videos of young people fighting each other, but really serious animal cruelty, for example, other bullying, other types of harassment that maybe aren't even aimed at young people, the just kind of sense of violence within social media was something that they said was ever present.
Yeah, I think Emily raises some very good points. One of the problems with social media is things like the algorithms and how we actually attract people to watch videos. It's about how it's shared, it's about how it propagates things like likes or things like streaks, and that kind of make it an addictive nature in terms of our young people. Social media itself, is that a cause of violence? I'm not so sure in terms of that. I don't think it helps. I think it's that accelerant. It can make things a lot worse in terms of what we're looking at. I think we have to have a, we need a serious look in terms of how we address it and how we police it from a national level, because I think there are real challenges with social media that actually a lot of the social media companies need to seriously look at in terms of what we're doing and how we're exposing young people to it, but also how we're exposing adults to it as well. We need to remember that young people are, if you like, learning machines. They come into this world and they learn from their community and parents and their adults and people around them. So when we look at young people's behaviour is actually sadly a reflection of some of our own behaviours. So we need to actually address our attitude towards social media as well. And how that also with social media and young people's attitudes and use of social media vastly differs from ours. Social media and internet and technology, we use it as a transactional sort of behaviour. We use it to do things. Young people kind of can blur the lines between reality or the real world and social media, and they both merge together. So we also need to look at sort of the work that Emily was talking about and actually listen to young people more about actually what would work and how we could address it and take them as the lead in order what we do with it.
Thank you. Do you want to go in first?
No, on you go.
I just want to illustrate this point with one of the evidence from one of those that from whom we heard. This was a 12-year-old girl who was vulnerable. She was befriended on social media, invited to meet the individual with whom she'd been befriended, found that in fact she'd been invited to an appointment where there were a crowd of people. She was then physically assaulted. The incident was filmed. She was left unconscious. She was hospitalised. Her parents didn't recognise her when they saw her in hospital. The video of the assault was then posted, not anonymously, but with the names of all those involved attached. They did that because they understood that in their minds, if you're under 25, the police won't, procurator won't take forward any action against them. They therefore did it with impunity. By thinking that and promoting that view, they are encouraging others to do the same. Now, I accept that social media, if you like, is a tool there that is being used by people who are disposed towards that kind of violence. But the more it struck me that there is a belief, rightly or wrongly, that that process, as was described, is accurate, it's going to encourage more of it, because the people perpetuating the violence were empowered. They felt that made them untouchable and, you know, within the peer group gave them status, however appalling that might be. So that is an example, I think, that we heard directly of what David and you are talking about. And, you know, it was very difficult not to be profoundly struck by that.
Yes. I think that's a really telling point in terms of some of the case you're referring to. If we go back to 2005, pre-most social media, if you like, you know, there was the instances of things like happy slapping, whereby, you know, people would be videoed actually being assaulted, and it was posted on things like MySpace, or the videos were shared in more general. Now, because we have that speed, and we have that alleged anonymity, and what you're saying, that sort of belief of lacking of consequences, it can make a significant difference to it, whereby people are posting things. It can encourage other behaviours. What we also know is, in terms of things like social media, in terms of that ability to share videos, is it's constant re-traumatisation for the victim, because it's, you know, it's constantly out there. It's hard to take down, even if the social media companies take down. It's been shared across WhatsApp groups, etc. It's not like a violent incident of old, whereby you might have been assaulted and sort of may be able to move on from it if it wasn't that, you know, too traumatising. That there is everyday traumatising, not just for the victim, but the victim's families and friends, etc. So it is horrific. Now, in order to address that, is this about sanctions? Perhaps. Behaviours have consequences, but we have to understand what those consequences are, and we have to understand what works best. We also have to support victims and support victims' families better, and we're not terribly good at that. You know, we need to actually think about sometimes from the victim's perspective and support the victims. At the same time, we do not want to see this violence. We want to prevent it. I wouldn't like to spend all our services dealing with victim services and dealing with trying to stop offenders from offending again. I would rather stop it in the first place.
One of the parents said that they were slightly aghast that the remedy was a series of actions that were put in place to support the perpetrator of the violence to try and take them out of that culture, but that the victim of the violence had received virtually no support whatsoever in terms of any kind of remedial support. David Torrance, sorry I interrupted.
No, that's okay. Convener, thank you. And this is questions to Mr. Waters, because some of the evidence that the committee's taken from families was around social media, the threats of violence or violence from social media, and they felt that the police had become immune to it, that there was no response from the police. So can you put on record what...
Mr. Torrance, yes, these videos are very concerning, and the instance that you talk about is very harrowing to hear those details. It definitely does compound the experience of the victim and their family. They have to live through that again and again if it's on social media. I don't take away for that at all. In my experience, it's not the main issue, it's social media. It's obviously the violence itself. And we, for every instance, we've got a victim care package that we try and a bespoke one for each victim, particularly if it's a young person, where we try and link in with the schools. We see if it's related to anything to do with gangs as well, and we try and link in with, for instance, campus officers as well that work in the schools. I think the system of youth justice is not very visible about how successful it can be. It is, there is a three different levels of youth justice, from direct measures in terms of the police. You might be surprised to know that 75% of children that are actually taken home in that first instance that are given a formal warning, they don't offend again. And then we move to early effective intervention, which again is about diverting youths away from violence and from offending. And it's been proven to be very effective. Glasgow, I can speak about Glasgow because obviously that's where I'm the community inspector for Glasgow City Centre. Early effective intervention does work. Doesn't work in all instances, but it does on the whole work. And obviously, if the offences are of a very high level, it will go to the appropriate fiscal or children's reporter. But we've got a system in Glasgow called One Glasgow, which is where the offenders are at that, where young people are repeatedly offending. We're intervening through a system called One Glasgow. We find that 93% of those that are referred to that actually get involved in that diversionary programme, and it's found to be very effective. So I think a lot of the time The effective measures are not visible to the public, which is unfortunate, but there's a lot of good work happening in the background.
One more, thank you. To yourself, Mr. Waters, again, these families didn't feel that the police would respond to any threats from social media to their children. Can you elaborate on what the police would, Scotland would do if these were constantly aimed at a child?
Obviously, we'd have to look at it on a case-by-case basis. But if there's a video and or if there's social media threats, then there's legislation through the Communications Act that we should be using, and we could prefer charges against those that are responsible. So there's legislation that we should be using for that, those types of offences. But again, we'd have to look at each individual case.
Mr. Charger, you've been keen to come in.
Good morning, panel. I've got a couple of questions. I think I want to stick by the social media first. There's so many fake accounts have been opened, and if it's an account has been opened by in my name, and I report it to the police that there's a fake account opened in my name, the response from the police is that sorry, you can't do anything. But that fake account puts up loads of stuff, which can be. Against, you know, so recently I've been getting quite a lot of complaint from ethnic minority people where the fake accounts has been opened, and it's for the young people. But when it's been reported to the police, police just walks away from it. Do you have anything to say on that one? Police says that you have to write to the social media company. Do you think that social media companies are not taking responsibilities, and it's quite easy to open an account on anybody's name without any background checks or anything at all?
A lot of the social media companies are based abroad, so it does make it more difficult for Police Scotland to engage with the companies and try and get their cooperation. But some do cooperate, and we try and make things better for the persons that are reporting that. In terms of fake accounts, again, it would be very much encouraged if the people feel as if their details have been used fraudulently, that they should report it to the police. I'd very much encourage that.
Thank you. The other thing is, I've been getting a lot of constituents who's got like shops or education centres. I mean, it's mostly from Leith, and their shops has been targeted by youngsters like 12, 13, 14, kicking the windows, kicking the doors all the time, and it's the same people. But when the police were called, the police comes up and says that they're underage people, can't do anything. And if the shopkeepers or the business owners go out and talk to the kids, their parents will come and start jumping on them. So, I mean, what kind of response should we give it to the constituents who is going through this sort of trouble? And I think these sort of things are happening more or less every single day in Ocean Drive and all that stuff. And I get constantly emails from the shop owners. So,
I think that's a very good point in terms of actually looking at the problems at a local level, and this is about how we respond to it. I mean, when we look at things like areas around about shops or, say, transport hubs or anywhere else where, you know, perhaps groups of young people are coming together and we're finding, you know, perhaps increasing antisocial behaviour, maybe low-level violence and these other crime and other issues, but actually, it's been said earlier, it's just young people hanging around. We know that instances, things like what works, is things like hotspot policing. So hotspot policing is incredibly effective, but actually hotspot policing is not just about policing and criminal justice. It's identifying where some of the challenges are and how we can best deploy resources. That could be multi-agency partnership resources, it could be youth workers, it could be street workers in terms of, say, you know, the kind of idea of a hospital navigator or a street navigator, to engage with young people and to find out what's happening and listen to why they're there, you know, and try and help them move along. We don't want to see young people being criminalised. We don't want to see young people being brought in the criminal justice system. But equally, we want to see people in community be able to go about their daily business and not be scared and be free from that sort of behaviour, you know, and shopkeepers and be able to continue on with their daily business. So there has to be some way of addressing that. We have to be able to deploy some form of resources for that. But again, that might take some funding, some money, in order to actually think, what do we want to do? Because this takes resources. It takes people resources to deal with people problems. And that's one of the issues we're faced with.
Oh, sorry.
I think it's worth also emphasising what Will said about talking to the young people involved and finding out what those drivers are. Is it that there's actually nothing else for them to do? You know, they've found something to amuse themselves. Just so happens that that's really inconvenient and, you know, really unpleasant for the people who are experiencing that. You know, money and youth work services, moving that upstream so that young people aren't in that position to be making those choices in the first place is really where we should be emphasising that fund and spend in that preventative measure.
Just last question. A lot of police stations, I mean, there's been an announcement that police stations will be closing. So do you think that, the local gurdwaras or mosque and things like that, when they know there is a police station nearby, a lot of the time they feel comfortable. The community who uses them, they feel comfortable. Do you think those closing down of the police station in the area is going to make people worried that there's going to be a lot of trouble? It will be for Mr. Walters to answer.
Yes, Mr. Chowdhury, I think people are more interested in where the police officers are as opposed to the physical buildings. And we've been given a lot of investment by the Scottish Government and for mobile devices so that officers can actually be in their areas and they can work remotely using their devices so they don't have to return to a physical building to do things like paperwork. So with advancements of technology, the buildings themselves are not as important. They might be symbols in the community in terms of the people know where they are. But if we can, obviously the police are just like every other public service, there's obviously budget constraints. So if they're looking to save money in buildings, well, the police officers will still be in the communities. It'll just be the buildings that might not be there anymore.
Thank you. Mr. Ewing.
Thank you, Convener. Some years ago, from 2007 to 11, I was Community Safety Minister, and along with Cabinet Secretary of Justice at that time, Kenny McCaskill, we worked very closely with John Kernahan and Karen McCluskey, and I was struck by both their passion, but also the practical approach that they brought. And particularly, I wanted to ask, and talking about preventing youth violence, as we've heard from Inspector Waters, about diversion activity, because does seem one of the key ways, and Inspector Waters, you've confirmed this morning, to take young people into a different path of life and thinking and away from mindless violence, is to provide diversionary activity. And at that time, we introduced this idea of cashback, using money taken from criminals, drugs money, for example, or other property seized, and investing that in diversionary activity. And what I wanted to ask the witnesses really is that still one of the main correct approaches? And if so, is it being supported sufficiently? I'm not just talking about taxpayers' money or resources, as people tend to call it, as if it was a type of mineral. It's not, it's money, but it's not just money. It's also a sort of will and a purpose amongst government agencies to get things done and not pass it to somebody else's desk. So I don't know the answer to this question, but I just wanted to hear from each of the witnesses, are we doing enough? Should we do more? And if so, how do we go about that? And what do we need to do perhaps now more of or better that could help to divert some of these young people away from some of the acts of absolutely mindless violence that we've heard in what were extremely harrowing cases, as the convener has pointed out?
Mr. Linden.
You raised some very good points in terms of what we need to do. When we went back to those days and cashback was introduced, and along with a number of other programmes that John and Karen helped to pioneer, we were looking at that idea of that kind of primary and secondary prevention and how we stop that transition of young people into crime, how we change behaviours, how we stop people carrying knives, how we engage with them. And that was incredibly successful. Some of the best evidence around that from an international perspective is round about some of the diversions out there, things like social skills training or sports or mentoring, things like navigators or that idea of supporting people in the community at that point in need. But we need to, and we need to invest more. We do need to invest more in our time, our effort, and make decisions that actually face our young people today. Because if we're not making the decisions on how young people are served by our communities, then we could be facing these future problems, and they'll only accelerate for it. Whose responsibility is it? It's everyone's responsibility. One of our mantras always going through in terms of what we do, and this is about leadership, but not necessarily just political leadership. It's about leadership at all levels and not looking to the left and to the right and say, well, actually, you need to do something. This is about us all doing something, whether or not it's political leaders, teachers, police officers, family members, community members, brothers, sisters. We all have a choice to make about violence. We all have a choice to make about our children's futures and how we spend our money, as you said, how we spend our resources, how we spend our time. There may well be political decisions through budgets, but actually we have to make a decision on what we want for the future.
Yeah, the cashback is a really great example. The programme's recently changed, has shifted some of that money away from smaller grassroots organisations. And I think funding across the third sector, for sure, has to be a consideration in the longevity of that. It takes a long time to build sustainable, meaningful relationships with young people. So if you're working on a one-year funding and then you don't get that, you know, the young people don't have that stability, they can't trust that process. And we see a lot of young people then falling out of services, falling out of youth work provision because of funding cuts, because the programme that they go to in the summer's been cut or whatever it might be. We've provided the committee with some examples of existing youth work, current ongoing youth work activities. And like Will said, it really takes a team. There's a really great example of a partnership between Children in Need and McDonald's, for example, where lots of McDonald's restaurants were facing antisocial behaviour and disruption from young people, so that instead of being punitive and banning young people from McDonald's, they're trying to then actually talk to these young people, welcome them in, do some employability work, for example, with skills. Young people are now then having part-time jobs in McDonald's, but also having detached youth workers there to support the young people who are there to have those trusting relationships. Yeah, lots of different things that are going on, and certainly more funding for youth work that can be embedded within our communities would be of benefit.
Mr. Linden, you wanted to come back again.
Yeah. Just to kind of back up what Emily said a little bit, particularly around about strategic funding. If we look at something like the cashback, where it might be 3 to 5 years worth of funding for organisation, that allows long-term planning and long-term development of workforces and long-term development of services and training of youth workers and training of people to be able to interact and work well with the communities. If we're dealing with things like year-to-year funding for many organisations and many third sector organisations and community organisations who do the vast majority of that really on-the-ground preventative work across Scotland, that's really difficult for them, particularly now when you're not, when you have troubles with funding, you don't know what the future is going to be. How can you make those sort of planning decisions in order to support your communities better? So I think we need to look at how we fund in general, particularly those smaller organisations, because those, as I said, those are the ones that make the real difference and make that, especially around that relationship building with young people, in order to help prepare them better for the future.
Mr. Ewing.
Longer term funding, not year to year, is the sort of death knell of schemes, because by definition it takes longer than a year to do anything worthwhile, by and large. I don't know if Inspector Waters wanted to answer the question about what the police role is, should be, what more could the police do, if anything, in relation to diversion activity. Inspector Waters.
Mr. Ewing, yes. One project that we're doing in Glasgow City Centre is the Common Ground Youth Project. And we can't do that. Obviously, the police can't do this alone in terms of providing that diversion activity. So this is a project which is going to be led by Bernardo's, and it's about having youth workers actually in the city centre engaging with young people who are sometimes on the periphery of groups, and trying to get them engaged and to signpost them to services back into their own community. Sometimes those services are limited, what's available, but there is more services back in the communities than there is in the heart of Glasgow or in cities. And I think that's a very important first step as well, about trying to make things better. Of course, we could be doing more, but by working with partners, we can at least enhance our chances of making a success.
Well, I'm sure you do a lot of good work, and as you say, sadly, much of it is invisible, which is a shame. We did it when I in those distant days when I had an executive function. We did use to some extent the army and army facilities, barracks, out of bounds establishments to take youngsters from Glasgow who I think John McCluskey said were kind of identified as about to go into serious crime. You know, they started doing criminal activity and, you know, John's view was just a matter of time if things took their course that they would get involved in more criminality, get involved, go to Glen Ochils, end up in Barlinnie, and so on. So his idea, I think, was, you know, to get them a room, give them one of his typical talks, which I imagine would make most people's hair curl. But also to take them out of their habitat, you know, the place they're happy with, maybe out in the scheme somewhere, and take them into somewhere entirely different, like, you know, Cairn Grahams or something like that. And the reason that I felt that the army was very good at this is that this is what they do. You know, they take young men mostly, but women as well nowadays, and they turn them into stronger, better team-playing people. That's what army training is all about. And they're very good at it. So I did feel, and maybe this sounds old-fashioned to some, but I did think that this was a strand, not the sole answer, but a strand that would help particularly young boys in their teens from becoming hardened criminals. And therefore, the minute investment involved would pay itself in spades in avoiding all the misery that such criminality would cause throughout their lifetimes for other people and themselves. Is that something that's happened, that's happening now, or has that been dropped?
I was going to ask if that was a reflection or a question there, Mr. Ewing, but I think we got to it at the end. Emily Beaver.
Yeah, there's certainly activities like that still continue with the army and with other providers, and I think maybe we're saying that, you know, some young people will really thrive in that very boundaried setting, you know, rigid setting of an army, and there's others who might not. So there are a range of providers that do that kind of system, taking young people out of their norm, right? Showing them that there's something different, and that's kind of what I was referencing at the start. If young people can't see a different thing, can't see a different future for themselves, it's really hard to imagine. And actually just that break and seeing the opportunity to learn something different. Venture Scotland's one to really look at that do lots of that, lots of outdoor provision as well, teaching young people outdoor skills and outdoor activities, spending lots of time in nature, you know, really in the health and well-being impact as well as the antisocial behaviour or perhaps involved in violence side of things.
Helpful, thank you. Yeah, when we look at these programmes can be effective in terms of what they're doing, but it's not just the programme. What it tends to take is actually a lot of work before and afterwards. Mm-hmm. So it doesn't matter if it's an outward bounds adventure course or perhaps a week, you know, residential with the army. You know, again, as Emily said, some young people might rail against that. But it's about the work you do afterwards, the support, the help. Because just taking a young person out of their scheme, their environment, the troubles, the trauma that they face on a day-to-day basis for a week's respite for it might give them a week's respite and a week's reflection. But then if you're putting them back into that same level of trauma, that same community, the same problems, etc., the gains can be quickly eroded. So what we found is, how do you support them when they come back? And that is through things like mentoring. It is through, you know, adults and peers and people that can support them on a day-to-day basis and look to try and challenge some of the behaviours out there, but also challenge some of the circumstances that got them there in the first place. So it's much more elongated than, say, a 1 week or even a months-long programme. When we're dealing with young people with significant trauma and significant issues, it takes a significant amount of time and a significant amount of resources to help change that.
Can I bring in Maurice Golden?
Thank you, Convener. I'm interested in the justice system response in the widest possible sense, and I welcomed the comments from Mr. Waters that there's kind of those three tiers, and I was interested, I think the statistic that you provided of when you take someone home, the reductions in reoffending 75%, which is amazing. But I'm really interested in perhaps the more extreme end, which I think you kind of finished up on in the three-tier approach. And if you could give the committee an indication of the likely consequences of multiple assaults, particularly where an individual might move from the children hearing system, and is that adequate, and then to the criminal justice system, and ultimately finding out that, anecdotally from my experience in Dundee, that individuals can sometimes rack up dozens of convictions, if you like, in the children's hearing system, then have a big shock when they enter the criminal justice system. And I wonder if you could perhaps provide a commentary on what the likely steps are in those hopefully more extreme cases.
So in the more extreme cases, obviously they would be reported to the fiscal, and there'd be a children's hearing, and then it'd be down to a sheriff whether to put in statutory measures, whether that person needs compulsory care in local authority. But that's obviously a very extreme measure. We're trying to intervene and provide diversions before it gets to that stage. So that's why, as I mentioned, I'm not sure about in Dundee, but in Glasgow, there's the One Glasgow project where this is people that are repeatedly coming to the attention of the police. Last year, there's 99 people in that system that entered that system, and it was very effective. But they don't just look at the individual, they look at the whole family, because quite often, as Will was saying, you might remove that person for a short time out the environment they are, but then they just go back. But if you maybe look at the whole family approach about what financial assistance can we provide, employability, do these young people have any hope for the future? It's looking at all that, and that's why schemes such as One Glasgow are very effective. In terms of the tier system, early effective intervention is actually quite effective. And when you get to the higher levels, then it's almost out with the control of the police what happens then, once it gets to the Procurator Fiscal and the court system. But it's trying to, the police really have an involvement before it gets to that level. And we do have a role along with other partners to try and prevent it from escalating.
I think it's really important that we ground this conversation in a children's rights-based approach. That's obviously, you know, front of everybody's mind at the moment, and looking at, well, what does a justice system for children look like? Because that's who we're talking about, their children. Even if they have been responsible for harm, we have to hold that uncomfortableness, you know, and have that difficult conversation of, yes, they need to be held accountable, and they also need help to recover from whatever they're going through, and that reintegration into society, that they're not lost causes that we need to ship off somewhere and hide away from everybody else. And if we're thinking of what child-friendly justice looks like, a really good definition that we use and share with practitioners is about a good friend can tell you when you've done something wrong, and they'll help you to do better next time. And I think that's what we really need to have here, that actually we have to help young people who are responsible for harm, for violence, to do better next time, that they're not the sum of their behaviours, even if that has been frequent, that we always have that hope and optimism for transformation and change, and that we'll be with them to do it. And we know from research, certainly from the Edinburgh study of youth crime and transitions, that their recommendation of following young people through their lifetime, who are now in their kind of mid to late 30s, is to maximise diversion from the criminal justice system. That it just doesn't work as it is for young people. It doesn't set them down a better path. And so I think we have to kind of keep all of these things in mind, certainly with incorporation now coming into force within the next few months, of what this really looks like and how this could really be a radical shift for our justice system for children.
And so you've articulated, I guess, what it should be. I suppose my question, to pick on some of Mr. Waters' evidence, is if a child is put in local authority care or indeed into a secure unit, is there any evidence that that has beneficial outcomes for the individual? And what is the panel's assessment on the effectiveness of the justice system response? I don't know who wants to pick up on that.
I don't know if I can comment on the
totality of that, but yeah. Certainly we work with young people within secure care and also sometimes in YOA Pullman. And they're some of the nicest young people you've ever met. Actually, they're always our easiest sessions. The young people are much more keen to be engaged than when we go into schools, for example, which is always really striking. But they're young people who are really vulnerable. They're there because they're vulnerable for a whole load of reasons and a danger potentially to others or themselves. And I think that we've quite often seen the same young people in that system. One striking example, we went to one secure care unit and the young person said, I've met you a few months ago in the other secure care unit, you know, still in that system. And there was another young person talking about, I have to go to Pullman later on. What's it like? They'd never been. And then another young person saying, my whole family's been in prisons. They've been in Barlinnie, they've been in such and such. So I think that gives you a sense of who those young people are, who that demographic is, and actually the level of support that they need. And the level of supports, you know, really quality within those secure care and the relationships that they can build with those staff. I can't speak to the statistics of that, but certainly from the young people that we've met, they need a lot of support to do better next time.
Okay, thanks. Well,
yeah, I'm not going to necessarily comment on whether or not the justice system's effective or ineffective. That's kind of outside my expertise on this one here. But however, what I would say is it could be better. We could look at it in terms of actually it's not down that silo route of just a justice system or a justice system response. Because if we look at the examples given of young people committing multiple crimes, multiple acts of violence, etc., it harks back to a phrase that ex-director of education, Maureen McKenna from Glasgow, once said to me, and that is, all behaviour is communication. So what is a young person they're telling you about their life in terms of why they keep committing crimes, why they keep getting involved in violence, why is this happening to them? And why is it not being stopped, or why are we not doing something about it? So if the justice system, in terms of how it exists just now, is not able to work and transform and transition young people in terms to, you know, make them have better outcomes or let them have better outcomes, whatever that looks like for them, we need to think about what else does it need. How do we work across our systems? How do we work across our mental health system? How do we work across our social care system, our education system? And that's the problem that we have. We have all of these systems, and what happens is we expect young people to navigate them. We expect young people to be part of a system rather than the young person to be at the centre of it and the systems to navigate around them. So would I say, you know, that it's perfect? It's absolutely not perfect, but it's probably the best it can be just now. We just need to think about it differently.
Thanks. I don't know. I'm not sure about in terms of at that level when it gets to children in sort of secure facilities and whether that's successful or not. It's really out with my area.
No, that's fair enough. Just a final question, convener, just around prevention and particularly the roles of schools in that, which we've discussed social media, but actually a lot of the violence you might imagine would emanate from the school environment, even if it doesn't take place there. And I wonder what the panel's assessment was on how effective schools are at that early intervention point, or indeed working with the police in terms of getting the community officer out. You know, anecdotally, I've heard that particularly at primary school, that's very effective, even in terms of combating social media abuse, for example. And I'm just keen for the views on the role of schools and the educational system.
Incredibly important in the role that schools can play in this. But you know, there's an old phrase as well that teachers can only teach what parents provide and what communities provide, and it takes a community to raise a child. There's so many adages around this. But the idea of schools being solely responsible for it is really difficult. Schools are there to help educate, to help train, to prepare young people for your future, and that's prepare them from the widest possible sense. They do a great job. But it's a struggling job just now in terms of what they've got. We've seen the well-publicised sort of issues in terms of teachers complaining about behaviour in schools and violence, and they probably need more support and help in terms of what they need. We can't keep putting things on schools in order to fix some of our social problems. There are wider issues at play, and we need to be able to support the schools in order to do that. So, and this goes back to the primary prevention and secondary prevention modelling. If we're wanting to truly help this, we need to help the schools more. We need to provide them resources, where or not it's in terms of additional help for, say, educational psychologists. We need to provide them things like mentoring and youth work, etc. We need a better relationship with our, we've got a good relationship with, for example, campus officers, etc., and the third sector. Schools need as much help as possible if we want to prepare our young people for the best future. I don't know if they have that just now, and I think that's one for the teaching unions and for teachers to discuss.
I think it's worth, you know, we've seen some really great examples of where schools have been really innovative in using the resources and time that they do have to support young people, but that's really quite mixed, and it's not a consistent picture, just because they don't all have those same resources. So, for example, campus officers are not in every school. There's some areas like Falkirk, for example, there's a campus officer in every school, whereas in others they don't have any, Aberdeen, for example. And it's where the school is able to have those resources, able to commit that time, able to develop those relationships with young people, positive relationships. That's what it all comes down to, isn't it? And I'm sure you can all think of teachers that you've had that, you know, were stood out and you had a really positive relationship with them. That's what we need for all young people. But teachers need to be able to have the kind of breathing space within the curriculum, within the school day, to be able to foster those relationships, and that can obviously be challenging.
I mean, I have a duty, I feel, to the petitioner and to the witnesses from whom I heard to ask this. They understand that the police operate within guidelines issued by the Lord Advocate. And those deal with the circumstances when alleged offences committed by children should be reported to the Procurator Fiscal. Can you explain what the impact of those guidelines is on the police who have to deal with allegations of violence? Does more need to be done to explain to victims what action is being taken or what action is not being taken? Because those witnesses and their experience was not abstract, it was real, were told by the police, they're under 25, there's nothing we can do, it's not worth it, the procurator won't act. In consequence, in both cases, the families then felt unable to leave their homes because they were coming into contact with the perpetrators who were provoking them further, mocking them, making their lives difficult within their community because they felt that they were now immune. And bizarrely to me, their parents seemed to be part of the posse of abuse towards the perpetrators. Gone are the days when some parents would have felt that, you know, they had a duty to act in respect of their children. Now they seem to feel they've got to defend them in front of the people that were being abused. What do you say to those people? Because I think probably they listened in some despair to the academic discussion we had at our last evidence session and tried to relate that to the absolutely appalling experience that they themselves had had and the lack of any response to it.
I think the response to that is quite simple. It has to be more transparent with the parents and more transparent with the families. The families need supported. They need help. They are being victimised. They are being traumatised on a daily basis through this. So actually, by not doing that, are we fulfilling our duty as public sector? Are we fulfilling our duty? I'm not so sure. I don't know, and I can't comment on the specific policing procedures and that in the fiscal, etc. But we do have to look after victims. We do have to look after the families better. If we're not doing that, it's incomprehensible, quite frankly. We are looking at people that have faced real traumatic challenges in life. They're looking at the victims, their sons, their daughters who have been assaulted, who have been affected by violence, and it doesn't stop. It doesn't stop. In terms of people are reconnecting with it and are actually continuing to actually provoke, and you talk about parents who are now supporting it, that's not new, convener. We've seen that back in the 2000s when we looked at gang members, etc., when parents were actively supporting violence. That's not a new behaviour. It's a behaviour that, you know, as many parents can't really understand either because they don't necessarily expect their own children to be involved in that. and perhaps there has to be a realism and a kind of a check on that. But we have to address that, and we have to work from a victim perspective on this, and not just from a perspective of prevention in terms of stopping that kind of tertiary prevention. And the first of all, from a victim's perspective, is there should be no victims. We should actually stop this in the first place. There should be no violence. We shouldn't rest until, you know, every young person, every person in Scotland feels safe from violence, rather than trying to deal with the consequences. But when there are consequences and the violence does happen, we should support the victims as much as we can.
Anybody else? Mr. Waters.
Convener, I think basically we do provide, I can't comment on those individual cases, but on the whole, a robust police response, because it doesn't matter if the victim is young, a young person, or an older person. It's the same investigation model that we use. We take witness statements, we view CCTV, and we report the circumstances, whether that's into the Procurator Fiscal or to the children's reporter. So there's no difference to that, and the guidelines are, and perhaps it's down to the leadership of the police from low levels like myself to cascade that to the officers, that we need to be more, as Will says, transparent with the victims. Young people can still be arrested and they can still be taken into custody, where it's in the interests not only of the young person but of the community. So we do have the police powers at our disposal. And the youth justice processes, I think, as I said for one of the first questions, are on the whole are successful, but it's probably not visible to the communities that these disposals and diversionary work's taking place. And it is a victim-centred approach. That's what we get trained from the very beginning. That's what we should be providing to the public. And I think in more cases than not that we do. But sometimes the system's not perfect. Sometimes people do get let down.
Mr. Ewing, you want to come with a very final quick follow-up.
Yes, just to follow suit in the kind of devil's advocacy, and out of fairness, I think, to one of the young females whose mother provided quite harrowing evidence of the assault on this young girl. The mother said, I won't mention names, but I learned afterwards that the girl who was the attacker had attacked no less than 20 children and was well known with the police. And in fact, I still continue to get videos or stories of attacks weekly. Now, I mean, I just mention this because, you know, over the years, I have heard this quite a lot. The police knew well that this individual had caused many other crimes, had carried out many other assaults. And I appreciate that that's just a general claim. There's no particular evidence behind it. But I mention it because I think it probably is not an isolated experience that many people, perhaps living in areas of extreme poverty, find that, you know, there is a young hoodlum who just causes endless mayhem and nobody ever seems to do anything about it. Now, I think this is extremely unfair to the police to just say that. And also there's a question about the police don't do its job, and then what happens when it goes to the justice system? Not very much, perhaps. There's that argument as well, Inspector. I'm aware of all that. But you know, I just kind of wonder, particularly from Inspector Waters, you know, what would you say to this mother that sees the female that attacked her daughter in a quite horrific way, leaving her almost unrecognisable from facial injuries and scared to go out at all? What would you say to the mother, and how is there anything more that the police or any other authorities can deal with to identify youngsters that plainly are causing very serious injury and harm to other people, other young people in Scotland?
It's obviously difficult with the case that you describe, because obviously I don't know all the details. There is, as I said, that kind of escalation process. There is clear guidelines in for the police. Sometimes members of the public, this system sometimes lets people down, but on the whole, I would say that it does work. There is clear guidelines in for the police about what we should be doing, and But the young people themselves, that's the difficulty, is that the persons committing the offences are young people themselves, so that we need to think about them in terms of the kind of public health approach. How can we actually divert them away from offending? Because it's not just simply, we're not really looking at punishing these young people, it's about how we divert them away from a life of crime. So it's a difficult question to answer because obviously the harrowing details, but I think there is, on the whole, a robust system in place that serves the majority of the public. I'm not sure if that'll bring much, I don't think it'll bring much comfort to the victims that you mentioned, but I would encourage people to report.
To run on a little bit because it's an important subject. Is there anything we've not said or anything that you might like to volunteer finally, just by way of comment for the record, just before I draw this to a conclusion? No? In which case, I'm very grateful to you. Thank you very much. Your evidence has been very helpful, very candid and forthright, and I'll suspend the session briefly. Thank you. Thank you very much. And our next petition, continued petition, is petition number 1864 to increase the ability of communities to influence planning decisions for onshore wind farms, lodged by Aileen Jackson on behalf of Scotland Against Spin.
The petition calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to increase the ability of communities to influence planning decisions for onshore wind farms by adopting English planning legislation for the determination of onshore wind farm developments, empowering local authorities to ensure that local communities are given sufficient professional help to engage in that planning process, and by appointing an independent advocate to ensure the local participants are not then bullied or intimidated during public inquiries. We last considered this petition as far back as the 31st of May last, where we agreed to write to the Minister for Local Government, Empowerment and Planning to seek clarification on what the Scottish Government mean by ensuring communities have a meaningful say on planning applications. The Minister's response refers to the definition of community set out in the National Planning Framework and notes that at the time of writing, a consultation was underway on effective community engagement in local development planning guidance. And members may be aware that that consultation closed on the 13th of September 23. The response goes on to highlight that the Government's Planning and Environmental Appeals Division have agreed to consider a refresh of reporter training on handling inquiries to ensure members of the public are able to give their views and to have those properly heard in a safe environment at inquiries. Now, we've received five submissions subsequently from the petitioner, the first of which comments on the response we received from the Minister, suggesting that clearer definitions are required in order to make an effective assessment of the effectiveness of planning guidance. The petitioner has also restated their proposals for enabling communities to access professional help, engaging with the planning process, which they suggest could be financed through an increase in planning application fees. Subsequently, an additional submissions from the petitioner draw our attention to the type of experience community groups face when confronting or being confronted by a developer's legal team during inquiries, and comments from the UK government that decisions on onshore wind are best made by local representatives who know their area. The publication of a deal between the onshore wind industry and the Scottish government with the industry, commenting that a well-resourced and efficient planning system is needed to enable projects to go ahead where they have local support. So, we've received a range of submissions from the petitioner, a response from the government, and obviously the consultation that they held has subsequently been published. Do members have any comments or suggestions as to how we might proceed? Mr. Torrens?
I wonder if a committee would consider writing to the Scottish Government once again and ask when it expects it to publish the outcomes of a consultation on effective community engagement and local development planning guidance, seek an update on the work to explore the scope for planning authorities to determine more applications for onshore wind farm developments, including the impact of onshore wind sector deals for Scotland has had on this work, and highlight the petitioner's continuing concerns about lack of professional support available to assist members of the public contributing to public inquiries.
Thank you, Mr. Torrance. Mr. Ewing.
Yes, I would say support to Mr. Torrance's recommendation, but just perhaps add something which is just hot off the press, as it were, and has arisen since the papers were provided to us for this meeting, which is that on Friday, in response to an inspired question, there was publication of a new depopulation action plan, and that this contains within it an apparent, convener, new approach to be taken to areas where there is chronic depopulation, notably parts of the Highlands, remote Highlands, although apparently one's not allowed to call remote areas remote any longer, and the islands. But in this document it says that the new approach will be, and I quote, local by default, national by agreement. Now, that suggests to me that local decisions will prevail, unless I'm missing something. But I raise it because I wonder if the clerks in the letter could draw the attention of the relevant minister, who's a different minister, I think, to this new paper, and ask if this new approach is going to influence the response regarding community engagement. Because on the face of it, at least for those areas suffering depopulation, which actually will be the areas where actually very many of the wind farms are proposed, this seems to me to be a new factor which the Scottish Government have brought in as apparently a, your new approach, a new policy. Sorry to go on at some length, but
I think that's a very fair point, and I'm very happy that we seek to accommodate that. It wasn't the suggestion I was expecting from Mr. Torrance earlier, but are we content, colleagues, to support Mr. Torrance and Mr. Ewing's suggestions as to how we might proceed? We are, thank you. Petition number 1916, request a public inquiry into the management of the Rest and Be Thankful project, lodged by councillors Douglas Filland and Donald Kelly, calling on the Scottish Government, Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to instigate a public inquiry regarding the political and financial management of the A83 Rest and Be Thankful project, which is due to provide a permanent solution for the route. We last considered this on the 17th of May last year and wrote to the Minister for Transport. But of course, since we last considered the petition, Transport Scotland has announced the preferred route for a long-term solution. The then Minister, now the Cabinet Secretary for Transport, provided details of this preferred route in her response. The response also notes that the proposed medium-term solution is a temporary solution intended to add resilience and operational benefits while the permanent solution is constructed. We've also received a submission from the petitioner raising concerns about whether the preferred route option is the right choice and how the solution will be funded, particularly when there is new government with different spending priorities. There's always going to be a view as to what the right choice would be. I think the important thing is here that we actually now have a preferred option, both for a temporary and a long-term solution. So I wonder how we might take this forward. Colleagues, any suggestions? Mr. Torrance.
Thank you, Convener. I was very tempted to close this understanding orders, but I would like the committee to write to Minister for Transport seeking further detail of delivery planned funding and governance for the A83 Rest and Be Thankful programme, including information on the work being undertaken to ensure the statutory process and constructions are completed without unnecessary delay.
Are we agreed? We are. I think we should ask for as candid a response as possible from the Cabinet Secretary, because obviously we are aware of statements being made in the Chamber on an almost daily basis about the inability to deliver on major projects, and I think we would want to understand where this sits within that framework. Petition number 1957, Home Reports to Make Surveyors More Accountable, lodged by Catherine Donaghy, calling on the Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to ensure surveyors are legally responsible for the accuracy of information provided in the single survey and to increase the liability on surveyors to pay repair bills where a home report fails to highlight existing faults in the condition of the property, at which point I note and excuse Mr. Chowdhury from our proceedings. We last considered this petition on the 17th of May last, where we agreed to write to the Scottish Government seeking further detail on its plans to review home reports. And in its response, the Scottish Government has stated its position that delivering the ask of the petition would be inappropriate, as the scope of the Home Report survey is outlined at the beginning of the report, and that members of the Royal Institution of Chartered Surveyors carrying out Home Report surveys are required to have a complaints handling procedure and professional indemnity insurance in place. The response goes on to note that the delayed 2020 review on home reports will now be progressed alongside the Government's work to update cross-tenure housing standards. Well, in the light of that, how might we proceed? Mr. Ewing.
I do think we might close this petition under Rule 15.7 of Standing Orders on the basis that the Scottish Government's position on the ask of the petition does remain unchanged, but also that the scope of the Home Report survey is set out at the beginning of the report and that members of the Royal Institution of Chartered Surveyors who are carrying out a home report must have a complaints handling procedure in place. They must offer independent third-party recourse to complaints, including alternative dispute resolution by the property ombudsman, and they must carry professional indemnity insurance. So in the light of all of that, I wonder if members feel that this is a petition that can be closed.
Are members content with Mr. Ewing's suggestion? Mr. Golden.
Yeah, I am in terms of the context of the petition, but I think in terms of home report, the petitioner might want to look at another petition within the same area to look at the effectiveness of home reports. But in terms of this specific ask, I agree with Mr. Ewing.
Are we agreed? We are. So we thank the petitioner for bringing the petition forward.
Given the reasons given set out by Mr. Ewing, I think we feel that this is a point at which we will have to close the petition, but I hope the petitioner has also taken note of Mr. Golden's comments as well. Petition number 2002, to ensure access to legal aid for people with disabilities, lodged by Grant White, calling on the Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to provide increased funding for legal aid cases, legal aid in civil cases for people with disabilities. And we last considered this on the 19th of April 23, when we agreed to write to the Law Society of Scotland and the Scottish Legal Aid Board. Now, we've now received responses from the Scottish Legal Aid Board and the Law Society of Scotland. The Legal Aid Board highlights its recent research into the experience of users of civil legal assistance, noting that the results were apparently overall positive. Responses to questions on finding and contacting solicitors did not reveal any significant differences in experience between those with and without a condition that limits their day-to-day activities. However, 8 respondents reported feeling that their disability had made it difficult for them to access a solicitor. And in its Equality Outcomes Plan covering the period 23 to 26, the Scottish Legal Aid Board are aiming to improve the accessibility of information about legal aid and its services with a focus on people with disabilities and other groups. So, an ask of the petition. The Law Society of Scotland's response states that the number of firms providing civil legal aid has significantly declined over the last decade by some 20%. And a lack of sustainable funding mechanism and fees not keeping pace with inflation are noted as being the contributing factors. In submission, it states that a mechanism for periodic review taking inflation into account is required to address the impact of inflation on the legal aid system. So, responses from the Law Society of Scotland, who appear to be amending practice to some extent, and the Law Society of Scotland. Do we have any suggestions for action? Mr. Torrance.
I wonder if the committee would consider closing the petition under Rule 15.7 of Standing Orders on the basis that regulations to provide an uplift of 10.2% to all legal fees were approved by Parliament in March 2023. £3 million has been announced to strengthen the access to justice for deprived communities and vulnerable groups, and neither Minister nor the Scottish Legal Aid Board can compel solicitors to provide advice or representation.
Thank you. And I might add that we note the additional measures the Scottish Legal Aid Board are trying to implement to facilitate access. Are colleagues content to close the petition at this point? We are. So again, we thank the petitioner for bringing the petition. There does seem to be some movement from the Scottish Legal Aid Board. Of course, it's open to any petitioner in the light of subsequent experience to bring a fresh petition if that does not make the difference that is hoped for. That brings us to agenda item 3, which is consideration of new petitions. And as I always do, because there could be people who are joining us to hear their petition considered for the first time, that ahead of doing that, we invite the Parliament's independent research body, SPICE, and the Scottish Government to offer a preliminary view or to offer us any guidance. This is an action we take because previously it used to be the first thing we then agreed to do, and that only delayed proper consideration of the petition. So we move to petition number 2050 in the light of that, which is to prohibit the use of recreational drones on national nature reserves without a permit from Nature Scott. A very interesting petition, I think, lodged by Lee Watson on behalf of the Than Seal Watch. The petition calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to amend the current guidance on flying recreational drones on national nature reserves so that use is prohibited without a permit, permits include a flight time, date and agreed flight path, operation is in accordance with the drone code, advice on the legal status of the wildlife and habitats is provided. The petitioner raises concerns that drones can be used both intentionally and unintentionally to cause disturbance to wildlife and can have a significant impact on the well-being of many species on national nature reserves. In particular, excuse me, raising concerns about impacts on nesting birds and seal colonies. Now, aviation and drones are subject to such is a reserved matter. As such, aviation legislation, including drone-specific legislation, is the responsibility of the UK Parliament. However, Nature Scott has powers to make and enforce bylaws for national nature reserves under the Wildlife and Countryside Act of 1981. In 2018, Nature Scott and the Partnership for Action Against Wildlife Crime in Scotland
raised concerns about wildlife disturbance by drones. The Scottish Government's response to the petition notes that existing law requires that licences are obtained where wildlife photography may disturb a protected species. The submission also states that the Scottish Government will ask the Partnership for Action Against Wildlife Crime in Scotland to consider whether its guidance on drones and wildlife needs to be updated and republished. So I think with the increasing prevalence of drones, this is an interesting petition in relation to its potential consequence for wildlife, both well-intentioned and ill-intentioned. And I wonder what colleagues might think. Mr. Torrance?
Thank you, Convener. I wonder if a committee would consider writing to Nature Scot to ask for an updated view on its concerns they raised in 2018 about wildlife disturbances by drones. How many complaints made about drones used has been investigated since 2018, and of those, whether any complaints were referred to Police Scotland, and whether it would consider creating a bylaw preventing the use of drones in the National Nature Reserves without a permit under the Wildlife and Countryside Act 1981. And this is probably key, Convener. I wonder if we write to Police Scotland and ask whether there has been any prosecutions for wildlife crimes in Scotland related to drone use, and if so, how many? And how many police investigations into suspected wildlife crimes arising from drone use have taken place each year since 2018? And how many investigations of this nature have been reported to a Procurator Fiscal each year since 2018?
Mr. Ewing.
I just wanted to make one suggestion and put one point on the record. One suggestion is that because drones are fairly widely used for various purposes, many of them, I think, legitimate, I think we could also perhaps ask Nature Scot and accept Mr. Turnsey's recommendations whether they think it would involve disproportionate costs to introduce such a licensing scheme. I would be concerned that such a scheme may be difficult to operate in practice for grounds of cost, not least because Nature Scot's budget apparently is to be slashed, and therefore will they be able to do even the workload they've got? I think perhaps, frankly, not. The point I wanted to put in the record, though, Convener, was that there is another side to these stories, namely that I have had a constituent who was extremely concerned that drones were used, apparently at the instance of a very wealthy voluntary body, in fact the most wealthy in Europe, with an interest in birds, to carry out surveillance of locals that lived near an area where that organisation felt that there may be wildlife crime going on. So they felt that drones were being used to invade their privacy. And I have raised this case with the Lord Advocate. And I just wanted to put that on record because, I make no judgment about the merits of this particular instance or any others. It's not for me to do that. But it is, I think, for me to say that there are two sides to this kind of story. It's not all one-sided. And there are people in the countryside now that are actually quite concerned about the inappropriate use of drones by pressure groups who have a particular campaigning interest.
Yeah, I'm grateful for all that. I wonder if we might also write to the UK government, since they are responsible for aviation. I think in this instance I would be quite interested to know what their thoughts are on a summarised version of the petition and just the issues arising from it, and whether, of course, there's a similar prevalence elsewhere within the UK, and whether that may lead them to think afresh about any regulation in relation to the use of drones. Are we content with all that? We are. Thank you very much. It's an interesting petition. We'll keep it open and we will be taking forward the inquiries that we've just set out. Petition number 2051, to improve the processes for protecting children and young people from traumatic incidents, lodged by Diane Youngson, calling on the Parliament to urge the government to establish a consistent and transparent reporting mechanism for incidents affecting the health of pupils in schools, and to review and improve upon the existing guidelines for schools in dealing with at-risk pupils, to place a law monitoring of reporting mechanisms with ultimate responsibilities being placed with Scottish ministers and local authorities, and finally to reform the exclusions procedure to include consideration of whether exclusions may cause further harm. Now, on the reporting and monitoring, the Spice briefing notes that all schools and local authorities are expected to use the bullying inequalities module in CMIS to record and monitor bullying incidents. However, Education Scotland's review found that the module is challenging to use and that national guidance is not being fully implemented, leading to inconsistencies. The Cabinet Secretary for Education Skills submission highlights the getting it right for every child approach, and in particular the role of a child's named person. She also highlights the counselling services in place throughout secondary schools, which are available for children 10 years and over. On exclusions, the 2017 national guidance is noted. The guidance states that exclusion should be used as a last resort and should be a proportionate response where there is no appropriate alternative, with the well-being of the individual being a key consideration. The Scottish Government held a series of summits on relationships and behaviour in schools last year. The Cabinet Secretary provided an update on this work to Parliament in November and announced that a joint action plan will be developed to address the issues raised. As part of this statement, the Cabinet Secretary also encouraged more accurate recording of all incidents of inappropriate, abusive or violent behaviour in schools. So, in view of the information before us, do members have any comments or suggestions for action? Mr. Torrance.
Could the committee consider writing to a Cabinet Secretary for Education and Skills to request a timeline for the development and publication of a joint action plan on relationships and behaviour in schools, and information about how the Scottish Government expects its call for accurate recording of incidents in school to be achieved?
Are we agreed, colleagues? We are agreed, and we will therefore keep the petition open. Thank you very much, and we will seek the information as set out by Mr. Torrance. Petition number 2058 to require all dog boarding kennels to install smoke detectors, smoke alarms and sprinkler systems, lodged by Julie Loudon, calling on the Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to improve fire safety within dog boarding kennels by mandating the installation of smoke detectors, smoke alarms and sprinkler systems. The Spice briefing explains that animal boarding establishments in Scotland must be licensed by local authorities under the Animal Boarding Establishments Act 1963. It requires that determining whether to grant a licence, a local authority shall have regard to the need for securing that appropriate steps will be taken for the protection of the animals in case of fire or other emergency. Conditions set at a local authority level can include more detailed requirements, although in 1963 I very much doubt that sprinkler systems were that widely applied or even available. The Scottish Government recently consulted on proposals to revoke the Animal Boarding Establishments Act 1963 and instead regulate animal boarding under the Animal Welfare Licensing of Activities Involving Animals brackets Scotland brackets Regulations 2021. In response to the petition, states that the Scottish Government's response to the petition states that this approach is being considered and could provide a more cohesive and robust framework for ensuring the well-being of animals being cared for. So an important consideration and petition. Mr. Goldham.
Thanks, Convener. I think we should write to the Scottish Government to ask when its analysis on the consultation responses to its consultation on the licensing of activities involving animals will be published, and if it will give specific consideration to fire safety in the forthcoming animal boarding regulations. I think as part of that letter, it's worthwhile highlighting rehoming centres, which aren't boarding kennels, but are a very similar facility, with the caveat that the dogs there do not have owners, but otherwise is essentially a similar facility, and presumably the requirements would be the same. I also wonder, and I'm relaxed about whether we do this once we get the response, whether we write to COSLA in terms of licensing requirements and whether local authorities would have the resources to check and on that, as well as the fire service to perhaps find how prevalent this issue is. I mean, clearly there's one case, but how often is that happening? And I think it's important for context to have the differentiation between rehoming centres and boarding kennels, but it might provide us with an indication of how prevalent the activity could be.
Well, those suggestions seem very worthwhile. Mr. Ewing.
Yes, I support Mr. Golden's suggestions. So just maybe add one inquiry which I think should be made, I'm not quite sure of whom, which is this, that obviously we have legislation on sprinklers in domestic flats at the moment, introduced, I think, around 2018, pre-COVID. At that time, convener, it's been drawn to my attention by a constituent, a builder of or renovator of flats, that the estimated costs that were given for the cost of installing sprinklers were very, very modest. Now, he tells me, for various practical reasons, they have risen astronomically, such that it might even make the construction of flats, in his instance, unviable. And I just thought I'd mention that, because if they have risen several times, not just by a thousand or two, but huge amounts, then I do think that at an early stage, we do, if we were to pursue this petition, we would need somewhere to get advice about the costs to kennels and other establishments that Mr. Gold mentioned. And I think just out of fairness and balance, I thought I should throw that in. Just last week, I got a letter from a constituent, which was quite alarming, really, because we all want safety. But, you know, would a smoke detector actually, you know, £100 be as effective? That was his argument, rightly or wrongly, with Parliament. And I voted for it, passed this sprinkler legislation. But it's turned out to be grossly more expensive than estimated at the time.
I think, to make as well. Thank you. So we will take forward the petition, mindful of all the suggestions that have been made by colleagues. Petition number 2059, to ensure pedestrian crossings cannot be disabled without... Sorry, in which case I'm just... I just wonder, sorry, referring back to the previous position, whether we should be writing to, what's the relevant kind of dog agency that we might take views from?
So you could, in terms of, I don't know in terms of boarding kennels, there's one at Happis actually near Forfar, but the rehoming would be Edinburgh Cat and Dog Home, which may have even made an assessment, and Dogs Trust have two places in Scotland.
I think, just in view of Mr. Ewing's comments, it might be worth us trying to establish one or two relevant associations to ask what they believe the consequence of this would be, what existing fire safety measures they do have in place are, or regulations in relation to all of that, because it could be that there are alternatives to a sprinkler system, and it might be worthwhile just investigating that.
Extremely profitable businesses.
No. So, okay, we can do that too. Sorry, that brings us to petition number 2059, to ensure pedestrian crossings cannot be disabled without an equivalent safety measure in place, lodged by Lachlan McDowell. And it calls on the Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to introduce legislation requiring that during roadworks or at any other point where a pedestrian crossing is disabled or otherwise bypassed, that measures to allow alternative pedestrian traffic flow are put in place, and any broken down or otherwise disabled crossing be rectified or have an alternative in place with 24 hours of being reported. This petition was prompted by experience of a pedestrian crossing in a busy road outside a primary school which had been deactivated. Now, the Spice briefing and the Scottish Government response both note that the Safety at Streetworks and Roadworks Code of Practice requires anyone undertaking works that require a pedestrian crossing to be suspended to agree with the Roads Authority what, if any, alternative arrangements will be provided for users of the crossing prior to the suspension of that crossing. And it's also noted that those undertaking works are required to take specific consideration of the needs of pedestrians, particularly the needs of those with small children, pushchairs, and those with reduced mobility, including visually impaired people and people using wheelchairs or mobility scooters. So in view of that, do we have any suggestions from the committee? Yes, Mr. Torrance.
Could the committee consider closing the petition under Rule 15.7 of Standing Orders on the basis that bodies undertaking roadworks are already required to consider the needs of pedestrians and must agree appropriate alternative provision with the Roads Authority before works takes place as set out in the Safety at Streetworks and Roadworks Code of Practice?
Are we agreed? Well, I think in this instance we will close this petition, but I think we can obviously draw the attention of the petitioner to the provisions that currently exist and to which there is recourse in the event of any pedestrian crossing being disabled. That concludes the public part of our meeting today. We'll meet again on the 6th of March. We now move into private session.